I want to feel you. I need to hear you. You are the light that's leading me to the place where I find again. Trusting.
I'm Brody Swanson. I'm pastor to children and families, and I have a tendency to get stuck in my desire to control.
In days that are full of really dark thoughts and emotions.
Intellectualizing my faith.
Thinking that I have to earn God's approval.
In making my kids my idol.
Believing that my self-worth is based on what I accomplish and what I do.
I get stuck in worry.
Hi, I'm Philip Griffin, senior pastor. In the past, I've been stuck in unbelief. Today, I can still get stuck at times in pride and in anger.
Uncomfortably stuck. You know, some of us are there, quite frankly. We look at that drama and we think, that's me. You know, some of you here today are there, you're stuck, you don't quite know what to do. Let me ask you a question. If your deepest, darkest sins were somehow projected right back here on these screens, would you be humiliated? Would you be embarrassed? If all of a sudden those things that you think have been done in secret or exposed in public, would you be shamed? What would you then do with that humiliation? What would you do with that embarrassment? What would you then do with that shame? Back when I was pastoring in Texas, there was a pastor also in a neighboring town who I had known as an acquaintance, and he was stuck in pornography. And it came to light in a very public way. What had happened is he would take the computer, the church computer, the same one used to project images up on screen, he would take it home with him at night. And one day he took it home with him and brought it back on a Sunday morning, and the technician didn't realize what he was clicking on. And when he clicked on the screen images, he clicked on the wrong images, and everything the pastor had been viewing that night before was thrown up on screen in front of his entire church. It was a pornographic type thing that was put up there. And all of a sudden he was stuck, exposed, humiliated, shamed, lost his ministry, was restored, was forgiven by his wife, by his family, but at much cost, stuck. What do we do when we're stuck? What do we do when we're caught in sin and we have no way out? What do we do if someone we love is stuck and caught in sin and we don't know what to do? Today, as we're getting into Scripture, we're in John chapter 8. Beginning with verse 3, if you've got a Bible, turn with me. If you don't have a Bible, there's one in your row. And you're going to notice that this passage is in italics, because there's some question as to the placement of this passage. But we're going to go through it, and we're going to walk from verse 3 to verse 11 as we go through this. The page number is listed for you, page 868. And we're going to see exactly how Jesus deals with people who are stuck in sin. Because some of us here today are in that very same place. So here we begin with verse 3. It says this: the teachers of the law and the Pharisees brought a woman caught in adultery. So, okay, she's caught in the very act. So they barge in on her room, on her house, I don't know where. They pick her up. She's probably wearing just a blanket or a sheet. They bring her out in public. They made her stand before the group and said to Jesus, verse 4, "Teacher, this woman was caught in the act of adultery. In the law of Moses, we are commanded to stone such women. Now, what do you say?" They were using this as a question to trap Jesus in order to have a basis for accusing him. Now, notice what's going on here. They bring this woman caught in the very act of adultery. Is she guilty? Absolutely. But if they were really interested in justice, think about this, they would have brought the guy too. Think about this. Last I checked, adultery takes two, right? But the guy's not there. They're just bringing the woman. Why? Because they're bringing her to try to trap Jesus because they want some basis on which to accuse him. And Jesus is between a rock and a hard place, proverbially. Because if Jesus says, okay, go ahead and stone her, he's violating Roman law, because Roman law forbids executions. If he says, no, let her go, he's violating Old Testament law, that's exactly what they want Jesus to do. They want Jesus to either violate the law of Moses or to violate Roman law, because they're looking to get rid of the guy. Jesus is brilliant. I mean, he's God. Listen to what he does. Listen to what he says as the story continues. But Jesus bent down and started to write on the ground with his finger. So he doesn't do anything. He doesn't say anything. He just bends down and with his finger begins to write. You know, I'm going to talk in just a moment about what I think he's writing or why I think he's writing, more importantly, but he begins to write. And then when they kept questioning him, he says nothing. When they keep questioning him, he finally responds. He straightens up and he says to them, "Let any of you who is without sin throw a stone at her." Now they have to be stunned. This group of people has to be completely stunned that Jesus would respond in this way. All of a sudden, he's reversing it and putting it back on them. You know, they thought, okay, he's going to violate the law of Moses, or he's going to violate the Roman law, and we're going to have something to hang around his neck. But now he's turning it back on us. Very uncomfortable for these people. And Jesus says, let the person who has never sinned be the first to cast the stone. And they have no idea what to do because Jesus is upholding the law. He's saying, okay, sin does need to be punished. Adultery does wreck lives. It does wreck marriages. It does wreak havoc on homes and families and society, and it has to be punished. But let the punishment come from the one who is sinless. And so they have no idea what to do. Here's the point, the main point of today's message. There is only one without sin. If you're taking notes, that's the main thing. There is only one without sin. Jesus says, let the one who is without sin be the first to cast a stone at her. There is only one. Romans 3:23 says, for we have all sinned. If you're following along in your outline, circle the word all. All means you, it means me. All of us have sinned, and we have all fallen short of the glory of God. And we read this in Hebrews as we continue on to talk about who Jesus is. It says this in Hebrews 4:15, for we do not have a high priest who is unable to empathize with us in our weakness, but we have one who has been tempted in every way just as we are. Isn't that, wow, a little bit consoling? But get this last part. But yet he did not sin. So Jesus is saying to the Pharisees and to the teachers of the law, in the presence of this woman who has been caught in the very act of adultery, let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone. And Jesus knows full well that there is only one who has never sinned. That is him, and only he has a right to throw the first stone. Only he has a right to sit as judge over this woman. That's the point that Jesus makes. And he doesn't pick up a stone, and he doesn't throw a stone. So go back to the screen for a moment. What if your sins were somehow broadcast on these screens? Would you be humiliated, kind of like the woman? Would you be embarrassed? Would you be exposed? Would you be shamed? What would you do with that? Now, this woman, what she does is she's not trying to justify herself. She doesn't say anything about that. She's not trying to defend herself. She's not saying, well, hey, what about the guy? She's not saying anything like that. She's just standing there guilty before Jesus. Sometimes that's all you and I can do. We're caught, we're exposed, we're shamed. Jesus says, just stand guilty before me and watch what I do. So there is only one who has never sinned. Point number one in the outline, notice this. There is only one who has never sinned, and he doesn't throw a stone. Verse 8, as we continue, it says this, and Jesus stooped down and wrote on the ground again. So Jesus, at this point, is stooping down and writing on the ground twice. Now, John, who does a really good job explaining all the details, and oftentimes where Matthew, Mark, and Luke don't explain the details, John explains details. And he goes out of his way to explain details. But here he does not explain this detail. He doesn't explain what Jesus is writing. I think all of us want to know, what is he writing? What is he bending down to write? But I think John doesn't tell us what he's writing because he wants us to understand why he's writing. See, Jesus with his finger is two times bending down and writing. When else in Scripture does God with his finger write twice? It's in the book of Exodus. In the book of Exodus, when Moses goes up onto Mount Sinai and spends time with God, and God with his finger, it says, writes the commandments on tablets of stone. And after God finishes the first time with his finger etching the commandments into tablets of stone, God says to Moses, by the way, the children of Israel are down in this drunken orgy worshiping a golden calf, and I'm burning angry against them. And Moses and God have this dialogue. Long story short, Moses goes back down. He is carrying these tablets on which God with his finger has inscribed the commandments, and he gets so angry when he sees what people are doing that he just takes the commandments and he busts them on the ground. He throws them and breaks them into pieces. He goes and he takes care of what's happening. He goes back up the mountain, and God the second time with his finger etches the commandments. I mean, read through the passages, Exodus 32 and on. It's interesting, or 31, the last part and on, just to see how God with his finger writes twice. It's a passage that really talks about the mercy of God, the patience of God when it comes to the sin of the people, and really the grace of God. I'll even go as far as to say the atonement of Christ is mentioned in Exodus. Because Moses at one point in the story says, God, if it be possible, take my life as an atonement for the sins of the people. Moses is saying, I know something needs to die for their sins. Blot me out of the book of life. Take my life, my very soul, and blot me out, is what Moses is saying. And God says, no, I'm not going to do that, ultimately, because that's what Jesus would do. He would be the atonement for the sins of the people. So when Jesus bends down and writes twice in the ground, I wonder if Jesus is doing it as a way of saying, the last time with my finger I inscribed the commandments themselves. Not only that, but this commandment on adultery, I wrote it. Not only that, but back then when I exhibited patience and mercy and grace, so too now with this woman I am about to exhibit patience and mercy and grace. And that's exactly what Jesus does. He exhibits patience, mercy, and grace. And furthermore, I can imagine Jesus saying, and I am the atonement that Moses couldn't be. That is why I came. Verse 9, at this, those who heard begin to go away one at a time. The older ones first, until only Jesus was left with the woman standing there. So what's happening? These Pharisees and the teachers of the law are trying to trap Jesus. Jesus bends down with his finger, writes twice, says, let the one who has never sinned throw the first stone, and they drop their stones and they one by one leave. They have no idea what to say. They have no idea what to do. Jesus, however, uses this as a time to teach a deeper truth. You see, here is the truth. To those of us that stand guilty, and we know we're guilty, and we know we're exposed, and we know we're shamed, and we know we're humiliated, and we stand guilty before him with the weight of our own sins, Jesus says, only I can cast a stone at you, and I won't. And the second thing is this. To those of us that tend to become judgmental and move toward condemnation of others, Jesus reminds us of our own sins and lets us know that we don't have a stone to throw. I mean, here's what's going on. So there is only one who has never sinned, and he doesn't throw a stone. Secondly, he doesn't keep us in shame. Verse 10, Jesus straightened up and asked her, woman, where are they, your accusers? Has no one condemned you? So this woman here is standing before Jesus, and she's got to feel this huge burden of shame. Just this shame. She has been publicly humiliated. She's publicly shamed, and she's standing before Jesus, and Jesus isn't going to let her stay in shame. This is good news, by the way. It's really good news. I looked up shame in the dictionary, and here's the definition of shame. Shame is a painful emotion caused by a strong sense of guilt, embarrassment, unworthiness, or disgrace. And you know what? As your pastor, I know many of you, I know I have in my life carried, and many of you carry around shame. A painful emotion, let me read it again, caused by a strong sense of guilt, embarrassment, unworthiness, or disgrace. It's so easy for us when we get stuck in sin, much like this woman is caught and stuck in sin, to get stuck also in shame and to believe now that we are damaged, that we are irredeemable, that we are beyond help, that we are beyond hope, that something is definitely wrong with us, that God is disgusted with us. And we start thinking those things. Some of us are here today, and quite frankly, you think God is disgusted with you. I think the woman probably thought, Jesus, you must be disgusted with me. But listen to what he says again. He says, woman, where are they? Has no one accused you? Notice he calls her woman. That's not a derogatory term, by the way. He calls his mother the same thing in John chapter 2. I mean, it's a term of respect. It's a term, I'm sure, how Jesus uses it, of gentleness and even affection. And he's speaking to this woman in this way. Where are your accusers? Where are those who were prepared to kill you? Has no one condemned you? Notice that the woman doesn't look back at Jesus and say, well, you're still standing here. I guess you accuse me, you condemn me. I think something inside of her is starting to take note that Jesus isn't her accuser. He's not her condemner. Jesus, in fact, is her redeemer and her savior. Something inside of her, I think, is beginning to click as she understands exactly who Jesus is and what Jesus has come to do. And Jesus doesn't see her with the eyes of disgust, but sees her with the eyes of grace. So many of us, quite frankly, we've got the wrong image of God. When it comes to how we see God, some of us see God as vengeful. We see God as angry. We see God as uncaring. Some of us have an image of God where he's kind of dangling us over hell's fires with dental floss, saying the Clint Eastwood, go ahead, make my day kind of a thing, ready to just drop us into the pit of hell if we step out of line. This is not the image that we have of God through Christ. The Bible says that Jesus is the visible image of the invisible God. Jesus says, if you've seen me, you've seen the Father. If you want to know how God responds to you when you're stuck in sin, look at how Jesus responds to this woman as she is stuck in sin, as she is caught in this very same thing. This is how he responds. This is what he does. Has no one condemned you? For those of us that are caught and stuck in sin today, we can now know that Jesus is our Redeemer, our Defender. He is our Savior. Ultimately, that's why he's come. And for those of us who tend to look down at others, who also get caught and stuck in sin, and we tend to become judgmental or critical or even perhaps self-righteous as these Pharisees and the teachers of the law have become, Jesus would say, I don't want you to move in that direction. Instead, in gentleness, I want you to point others to who I am. I am the one who has come to redeem, to forgive, to restore, to set free. This is why I've come. I kid you not, this is a true story. And you can kind of Google beaners and pointers, bean throwers and pointers online, and you can find something that was, well, in play in the American church in the 1800s. In the 1800s, in the Midwest, there were church offices. You could be like the church pastor. You could be like the president of the board. You could be like the secretary. Or you could be the bean thrower and the pointer. I'd like the bean thrower thing. The bean thrower would sit in the choir loft and throw or shoot beans at people that were dozing off. I'm serious. I'm not making this up. And the pointer would locate themselves somewhere in view of others where during the sermon, whoever needed to apply the particular passage, they would point at them. So like on adultery, that'd be you, sir, you know, or you back there. I'm not pointing at anybody. Don't come back at me. And they would actually point out who this was that needed to take note of this. You know, today we don't have bean throwers and pointers, but we do have many self-appointed pointers, don't we? Pointing out the faults in other people. Perhaps shooting, not beans, but judgmental glances and maybe a few words behind their back and treating them with kind of a condemning way, kind of a self-righteous way, kind of what these Pharisees and these teachers of the law must have been feeling as they bring this woman and put her right in front of Jesus, probably wearing only a blanket. You know, sometimes we tend to move in this direction. When it comes to people caught and stuck in sin, Jesus would tell us that we aren't to point and shoot. Here's what we are to do. Galatians 6:1, brothers and sisters, if someone is caught in a sin, John chapter 8, verse 3, the woman was caught in the act of adultery. If someone is caught in sin, listen to this, you who live by the Spirit should restore that person gently. I like the word gently because that's exactly how Jesus interacts with this woman in John chapter 8. You who live by the Spirit, you who are empowered by the Spirit, should restore this person with gentleness. But watch yourself, or you too may get tempted. In other words, watch yourself because you too can get stuck in sin. And you can get stuck perhaps in the sin of self-righteousness. Or you can get stuck in the sin of condemnation. Just as this woman is stuck in the sin of adultery. And he says, watch yourself. Here is how we react to people who were caught in sin. We aren't to pick up stones, point fingers, or shoot things like judgmental words or glances, but love and restore them gently. So some of us are here today, and like the woman, we are caught and stuck in sin. And you know that you are. You're here today, and you feel kind of uncomfortable. You watch the drama, and you think, that's me. You know, I'm there. That's kind of like my life. I'm stuck right now in that battle, and I'm being pulled in the wrong direction. You know, there's good news. There's hope that there really is. That's why Christ came. If that's you, others of us are here, and we're stuck in something that's a little more hidden and a little more perhaps destructive. We're stuck in the sin of self-righteousness. C.S. Lewis, in his book, Mere Christianity, great book, by the way, if you've not read it, writes these words, and I'm just going to read about three sentences. If anyone thinks that Christians regard sexual sin as the supreme vice, they are quite wrong. The sins of the flesh are bad, but they are the least bad of all sins. All the worst pleasures are purely spiritual. The pleasure of putting other people in the wrong, or bossing and patronizing and backbiting, the pleasures of power and of hatred, for there are two things inside of me. There is the animal self and the diabolical self. And the diabolical self is the far worse of the two. That is why a cold, self-righteous prig who goes regularly to church may be far nearer to hell than the prostitute. But of course, it is better to be neither. C.S. Lewis, Mere Christianity. Interesting. As Jesus stands in front of the self-righteous, as Jesus stands in front of the adulteress, let he who has never sinned cast the first stone, were his words. So there is one, only one, who has never sinned. And number three, he sets us free to leave our life of sin. That's what he does. So he says to the woman, has no one condemned you? Listen to verse 11. She says, no one, sir. Then neither do I condemn you, Jesus declared. Go now and leave your life of sin. Notice what Jesus says to her. He says two things. Neither do I condemn you. Go and leave your life of sin. Neither do I condemn you. Go and leave your life of sin. Grace. Neither do I condemn you. Truth. Go and leave your life of sin. Jesus embodies both grace and truth. Problem is that as followers of Jesus, a lot of times we kind of choose one of those over the other. You know, it could be that we choose a lot of grace and we kind of ignore the truth. I think a lot of Christians are willing to say, neither do I condemn you, but we don't say the truth part, go now and leave your life of sin. And we need to embody both. I think a lot of churches say, neither do I condemn you, and stop there. But Jesus is full of both grace and truth and wants us as his church, wants us as his followers to fully embody both. So, whereas a lot of churches may say, neither do I condemn you and stop there and pretty much anything goes, a lot of churches on the other end say, go now and leave your life of truth, but there's a whole lot of condemnation in the process. And there's not a whole lot of love. Jesus says, be people of grace and of truth. Be a church of both grace and of truth. You see, full of grace, Jesus is gentle and compassionate. He's forgiving, and he sets this woman free. And full of truth, Jesus is firm, and he's direct, and he's accepting of the woman, but not of her sin, not of her behavior. So how does Jesus set us free? Because he does. How does he do it? Here's how he does it. He takes the condemnation for us. As we stand guilty before him and we deserve death, he says, I'll take that condemnation for you. I'll be condemned so that you can be set free. This is exactly why he came. This is exactly what the cross is all about. It's all about this, so that we who receive him, who believe in his name, might literally have this freedom. John 3:16 is a verse so many people know. If you don't know it, look it up. But John 3:17 says this. It says, "For God did not send his son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through him." So Jesus didn't come to condemn, but to save. How did he save? He saved by taking the condemnation on himself. Whoever believes in him is not condemned, but whoever does not believe stands condemned already, because they have not believed in the name of God's one and only Son. You see, the Pharisees and the teachers of the law were exactly right. They were. Sin needs to be punished by death. They were right. The Bible says that. God says that. Sin needs to be punished by death. Jesus was completely aware of this. That's exactly why he came. Over 600 years before Jesus went to the cross, Isaiah writes these words in Isaiah 53, "But he was pierced for our transgressions." Notice that he writes these words as if they've already happened, because this was a part of God's plan all along. Referring to Jesus' death. Listen to this again. "But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. The punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds we are healed." The word healed there means saved, delivered, made whole. "We all like sheep have gone astray. Each one of us has turned to our own way. And the Lord has laid on him," on Jesus, "the iniquity, the sin, the condemnation of us all." So, are you caught in sin? Are you stuck in patterns of sin? Are you stuck in things that you know leave you shamed, leave you exposed, leave you guilty? They destroy your relationship with Christ, and even now, even today, they are destroying that relationship with Christ. Jesus says, "I offer you grace." I do. "Because I have come to take your place, and really the death that you deserve. I'll die the death that you deserve, and I'll live the life that you should have lived. With me, I'll empower you to have that gospel life that I've come to give you." Jesus can offer us grace as well because, well, he took that condemnation for us at the cross. Do you need that grace today? So are you like this woman? Are you standing guilty before Jesus? Maybe sitting guilty before him even today, where you need to say, "Jesus, forgive me, cleanse me. I need what you came to do." Or maybe you're a little more like the Pharisees and the teachers of the law, and you need to say, "I'm stuck in condemnation. I'm stuck in cynicism. I'm stuck in forms of self-righteousness. And instead of being gentle with those that are caught in sin, I'm doing what these people are doing. I need your gentleness. I need to get unstuck from this pattern in my life." Are you today stuck? If you're stuck in any form that I've just described, I'm going to ask you to be really bold and to stand, and I want to pray with you. And we're going to pray, and we're going to talk about God really breaking the chains that bind us. And we're going to sing about God breaking the chains that bind us. If there are some chains that are causing you to be stuck, would you stand and let me pray with you as we close? Lord God, some of us are standing up today because we need to be set free. We're stuck in sin, much like that woman was stuck much like she was caught in the act. We're there. We're spinning. We can't get out. Jesus, we want to hear your words. And may we hear these words today from you. Neither do I condemn you. Go now and leave your life of sin. And Jesus, we not only want to hear those words, but we want to be empowered by your Spirit, Christ, you in us, to not move to shame, but to receive the new identity you've given us and to truly leave the life of sin behind us. Give us the power, the strength to do just that. Jesus, that's why you came. Thank you. And some of us are standing also today because, well, we need your gentleness. We need your gentleness so that we might restore the people around us. Forgive us for attitudes of condemnation. Forgive us even perhaps for attitudes of self-righteousness and cynicism as we've looked at other people. Forgive us. Break those chains in us as well. May we also be set free. Thank you, Jesus, for bearing the condemnation of this sin as well. Thank you for the cross. Thank you for your life in us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.